There are a lot of stories in this old vessel. Built 68 years ago for Henry Founds, she sailed many a sea and been used to the extreme. There are thousands of other wooden boats that have fallen into such disrepair, most of them just rot and disintegrate. Fortunately, this is not always the case.
The Sausalito-built schooner Zaka, flagship to swashbuckler Errol Flynn, is a good example. After 35 years of hard use, Zaka sank into the mud of a harbor in the south of France, and over the course of the next 25 years, deteriorated to the point that she was practically worthless. In 1990, Zaka was rescued by someone who had both the vision and resources to restore her to her former glory. Today, Zaka sails as one of the most beautiful schooners in the Mediterranean. But Zaka isn't the only story like this. Take Santana, for instance. There are few sailboats that have the history and the lines of the one designed by Olin Stephens in 1935, the 62-foot-long schooner Santana. She was built for W.L. Stewart, Jr., the heir to the founder of the Union Oil Company. Stewart wanted a schooner that could show her heels to the best and the brightest on both the Pacific and the Atlantic coasts. Santana raced in many Southern California regattas, and in the 1936 Transpac, she finished second in class to the yawl, Dorade. In 1938, Stewart entered Santana in the Newport to Bermuda race. To get her back east, he had her lifted onto the deck of one of the family's tankers and brought her through the Panama Canal. Stewart took the train. The Newport to Bermuda race was a success for Santana. She captured the schooner trophy by 4 hours, 36 minutes, 25 seconds. The overall winner, however, was the Sparkman and Stevens yawl, Baruna. Yawls were all the rage by 1939, and it only took Stewart's wife, Julia, to suggest that he get a bigger boat to accommodate him and all his fat friends to put Santana on the market. The schooner was quickly snatched up by San Diego businessman Charles Isaacs and his wife, Eva Gabor, the infamous Hollywood Hungarian who once said, "It is just as easy to marry a rich man as a poor one." In 1941, Santana was sold to heartthrob George Brent, who converted her to a yawl. In 1944, Santana went to Ray Milland for a grand total of 3 months, then on to Dick Powell and June Allison. In 1945, Powell sold Santana to someone who would turn out to be one of her greatest lovers, Humphrey Bogart. No matter how many owners there have been, Santana became, for the next 12 years, Bogey's boat. Humphrey Bogart was serious about sailing. An actor needs something to stabilize his personality, something to nail down what he really is and not what he's currently pretending to be. He sailed Santana 40 weekends a year and won most of the races he entered. Also on board was the other love of Bogart's life, actress Lauren Bacall. Bogey, Bacall, and Santana hosted many of Hollywood's greatest stars, Ingrid Bergman, Richard Burton, David Niven, and Frank Sinatra. The only change Bogart made on Santana during the time he owned her was the addition of a drink holder around the base of the binnacle. One night after a race, which Santana won, he was asked, "What makes the boat go like that?" Bogey said, "Scotch," and walked away. The drink holder was being put to good use. Bogart's health failed him in 1957, and he died in his sleep on January 14, 1958.
The estate let Santana go to San Diego decorator Willis Short, who in 1960 sold her to retired general and oil man W.H. Nickel. Nickel brought her up to the Bay Area and handed her over to Babe Lamerton to take care of.
Babe and Nickel raced her on the bay more than 20 times a year, and in 1961 did the Transpac for the second time, finishing sixth in class and 19th overall. Santana also participated in the St. Francis' Big Boat Series and three races to Mexico. In 1965, Santana did the Transpac again, finishing fifth in class and 25th overall. Nickel was very competitive and became frustrated with a lack of success. And in 1966, decided it was time to sell the boat. William Solari, a wealthy attorney, bought Santana with the intention of racing her. He offered Babe Lammerden the job of continuing as captain, and he accepted. Solari's most ambitious project was entering Santana in the 1968 Bermuda race, 30 years after her triumphant debut there. Babe and his wife Liz sailed the boat through the Panama Canal and up to Newport for the race. With the newer boats getting hard to beat, Santana did poorly and was brought back to San Francisco for social racing, then no racing at all, sitting in her berth, unused.
In 1971, Santana was sold to Charlie Pete, who sailed her around the world. The boat took a beating. Her mizzenmast was blown off. She barely made it home. In 1973, she was sold to M. Lloyd Carter, a Marin County drama therapist who also wanted to sail her around the world. The boat was a shambles. 44 of her 125 frames were broken. She couldn't sail across the bay, much less around the world. Then the same year, fortunately, Tom and Ted Eden took Santana on as a project. And 2 years later, she was sailing again. In 1982, with Tom Blackaller at the helm, in a match race with Durade, the boat that beat her to Hawaii in 1936, Santana finished more than 6 minutes ahead of Durade over a 12.5-mile course. Sadly, in 1993, Tom Eden passed away. Santana started aging again. She sat in her berth behind the St. Francis with little maintenance. In 1997, she sank. After she was refloated, the insurance company decided to put her on the market.
Paul and Chrissy Kaplan, longtime Bay Area sailors, had owned many a boat. But when they saw Santana, they recognized her magic. They purchased the vessel and embarked on a very difficult year-long project. Fastenings were pulled from the hull and proved to be in remarkably good condition. The interior, on the other hand, was a complete mess. Everything needed to be replaced. The engine was a ball of rust. Chrissy began the project by removing the cockpit. Then out came the engine. And all that remained was 63 years' worth of oil and crud. The masts were removed in July of 1998, the end of Santana being yawl rigged. In the spring, a schooner will reemerge. After countless layers of bottom paint were removed, the hull was saturated in epoxy after drying. The aft cockpit lockers were removed, and a new deck laid where the mizzenmast once lived. Then the same for the mainmast and chain plates. New bulkheads were fitted, and a new galley took shape following the original plans, with a few modern conveniences hidden away. To ease future removal of the engine, a fiberglass cockpit was designed, so a plug was built and the new cockpit installed. At the same time, work progressed down below deck. Furniture was rebuilt, exposing areas that had not been seen for 50 years. Out went the old nav station and in came the new. It was a team effort, from the building of a new spruce foremast to designing the custom hardware that would be installed once the mast was finished. And yes, even a bit of magic was involved. Rather than disturb the stem of the boat to install the necessary bowsprit, the ingenious team designed a carbon fiber bowsprit that was made to look like the original. Then came time to paint the hull. Things were nearing completion, and the cover came off. Her masts were stepped, and a schooner is reborn.
When Humphrey Bogart said an actor needs something to stabilize his personality, something to nail down who he really is, not what he's currently pretending to be, He was really referring to anyone who goes out on the water, particularly on a wooden boat. Better yet, to fully restore a classic yacht like Santana, for a true sailor, is the fulfillment of a dream.